First of all, so this work is done by Hang Yi, my PhD students, in collaboration with us. So first of all, we'd like to thank the LCN community for actually giving him a grant, which unfortunately he couldn't come due to visa reasons. And likewise, he got another grant, again, he couldn't accept it. So the bulk of the credit of this research goes to him. Okay. I'm here to present the work, and whatever mistakes that I say are all my fault, not his. Right? Okay, so let me start. Okay, so I'm going to take you all through this schedule thing. So first of all, I think the most important thing is to actually talk to you a little bit about what nanonetworks is. Right? Nanonetworks is actually a completely what I consider a new frontier in networking. It actually forces us to think very different from what we have been so used to. Right. Okay, so this is graphene. Right? Graphene molecules. And basically they are very small. Okay? And it became quite sort of came into existence, people started looking at it in about 2007, which is 10 years ago. Now, nanonetworks actually started with two physical layers. One is molecular comms, and now the RF comms based on graphene. Okay. Molecular comms talks about how molecules can be used to carry information around that. So that seems to be the big area. When you talk to most people doing nanonetworks, that's what the area is. But this thing, using RF-based or EM, electromagnetic-based comms, came about much later. So as you can see, this paper published in 2010, and I would say that a lot of work was done by Jonet, which is a PhD student of Achilles. So they are the ones who actually got this thing really kicked off. So, and based on what you can see here, a little nano device is in the range of like micrometers. Right. And we're looking at this device that is the size of a red blood cell. So imagine when it gets fabricated, you know, it gets pumped into your body and suddenly there's an internet in your body. Scary, right? Okay. Yes, that's what the world is going to be in the future. Be prepared for it. So that basically says that, right, you get antennas that are totally different from what we're used to. And one of the first things we found out when we started doing this research is that the Pavlov's model is totally messed up. You cannot assume the Pavlov's model because the Pavlov's model typically assumes transmission ranges of about a meter. Right? So when we first started looking at this thing, that was the thing that almost sort of messed up all whatever thoughts we have. I'm not a physical layer person, so I'm just building on top of the vast good research that the physical layer people have actually done. Okay? So basically what happens is that they have small antenna size. So the transmission is very simple. It is actually this thing called time spread on-off keying. So how do they transmit? So it's actually what we call femtosecond pulses, 100 femtoseconds. So what is a femtosecond? 10 to the power of minus 15 seconds. That's how small it is, right? So we have this 100 femtosecond pulses, right? And the way they transmit it, if there's a pulse, it's one. If there's no pulse at that expected time, it's zero. So it's a very simple thing. Pulse, one. No pulse, zero. And so it sort of predicts that kind of time. And it's, the transmission has been done in the terahertz range, so it's 0.1 terahertz to 10 terahertz range. So you just imagine, when you're going at this kind of range, you can actually have terabits per second of information coming out. Right? If you let every single device just blast out, you actually have a whole huge amount of data coming out. Right? Okay? So we're going to see where that's going to be a problem. Okay? So because of that, you have really lots of throughput. Now, and also because if you look at it, the range of, the duration is so small, right? Unless you're so really, really, really unlucky, you're gonna have pulses coming together. So actually, it's also a good thing. You don't have that much collision, you don't have that much interference. Well, and everything seems great, okay? Well, really what we call fat hole, right? Because at this frequency, actually what is gonna happen is that what we call molecular adsorption, water, is gonna cause a lot of problems. So when you have a environment where it's pretty humid, okay, and then it's going to absorb all your transmission. It's going to totally mess things up for you. Right, now this is a, so the other thing, so every time when people ask me, why are you doing this? Is it going to become real? Right, so what we are saying that yes, it is going to become real because a bunch of researchers in Australia actually characterized terahertz COPs, okay, for monitoring human lungs with wireless sensor networks. Right? So I wasn't lying, okay, you're gonna have these little things in your lungs soon. Right? How are you gonna get it in? They'll probably spray it through the air and let you breathe. And then it goes into your lungs. But of course, we're talking about for medical, you know, kind of reasons. Now, if you look at the so-called sweet spots, right, because of the molecular adsorption, right, when the amount of vapor in the air changes, right, your transmission can be perfect or zero, very bad. Right? So they are finding all these little sweet spots to actually transmit information. Right? So what they did actually, in fact, our structure of the network is built on top of that. So you have all these nano sensors that transmit what we call nano sinks, slightly bigger devices that can do a little bit of work. Right? And then from there, you transmit to a receiver. So what they use is actually a smartphone as a receiver, as a gateway. But you imagine, okay, we're talking about nano scale, right? It's not unheard of if your network is like 10 centimeters by 10 centimeters. So if you have a 10 centimeter by 10 centimeter network, you can't afford to have too many smartphones being the gateways of such networks. Right, so anyway, I hope that's a sort of motivation. Okay. So now what is the problem? Well, so this is our architecture. So the problem is that you have a whole burst of data coming in to this gateway, and then this gateway is going to communicate to the backhaul. So actually for us, I would say that to the best of my knowledge or our knowledge now, we are the first to actually look at it from the whole system's perspective. Now the scarier thing is that machine type communications, device to device types communications are assumed to carry very little data. Right? If you look at LoRaWAN and all that kind of stuff, it's always assumed to be low sensing rate and all that kind of stuff. But then you have this bind, you have this sensor network that is nanoscale and it's going to push out terabits per second of information. So then you have this, you know, chunk of data coming through here, trying to push through, and here at the backhaul it's going to block you, going to be blocked. You don't have the kind of bandwidth that's going to allow you to send. Right, so this is what happens. You have a lot of pulses coming in that comes to this, and here is at most, this is the number of pulses that backhaul is going to allow you. Okay? So one thing you're going to do, I'm going to limit that. Okay? So this is what happens. If I limit that, oh fantastic, I can do that. Right? But how do I do that? That means I'm really underutilizing the bandwidth. So ideally, we try to sort of balance the both. Okay? And that's what this piece of work is really trying to do, to balance the backhaul bandwidth and just collect enough so that I can fill up. Obviously, there's the ideal case and then after that, how close we can get to the ideal case. Right, now, so what is the ideal case? The ideal case, so this is the bandwidth, okay? The capacity of the so-called the channel. So the ideal case would be that, right, the pulse, the length of the pulse, plus the interval, and the inverse of that will give you the capacity in terms of bits per second, right? Okay, and so this is, so depending on how fast you want to transmit here, the length of the pulse, followed by a gap before the next pulse, and so forth, this is the kind of capacity you can get. So if you just let it go without even controlling, you probably get, you know, huge bursts of data coming in, right? So but then I'm saying that the gateway is going to limit you, so the best thing to do is that, right, the best thing for me to do is that, I put the capacity to be limited by the bandwidth provided by the gateway to the backhaul. Okay? So now if you look at it, it becomes pretty simple. This is a fixed value. This is a fixed value because the pulse is 100 femtoseconds. And that is not done by us. It has been proven that's a good number. So essentially, the only number that you can vary is actually the interval between the pulses. Right? And that's what we are trying to do. Okay? So the so-called ideal interval between pulses would be given by this, right? And it is limited by the bandwidth that the backhaul provides you. Now, you'll be wondering, why don't I buffer? Well, that's true, you can buffer. If you have a smartphone, you probably have enough data to buffer. But if you look at Little's Law, how many of you doing queuing theory here? Queuing theory? Right, Little's Law, right? If your arrival rate is always greater than your service rate, no matter how much you buffer, it's useless. Right? Okay. And it's pointless that if you make all the nano devices keep transmitting and transmitting and then you're just going to chuck away the packets, then you're actually just wasting stuff. Right? So, but then the thing is that we're looking at gateways that are not going to be smartphones, they're going to be small devices. Alright, so now you look at this. Now, if I have, let me just clarify, right? I'm using the model of sensors to sync and then sync to gateway, right? That's what I showed earlier. So what happens is that the sync is going to sort of push out pulses this way. Ideally, what comes to the gateway should be spread out in this way, pulses with this ideal interval between the pulses, so that it sort of perfectly matches the bandwidth provided by the backhaul. Right, so that's what we hope to get. So how do we achieve that? Right. So first of all, we came out with this idea or this scheme called adaptive pulse interval scheduling. Right, and again we need to thank the reviewers because our original title was kind of misleading, and it was suggested to us that we should call it something different, and that's what we did. So the scenario is that we have a distributed scenario, and we're looking at event-driven bursty traffic. So event-driven bursty traffic in a medical condition. So it's actually, for example, you get a heart attack or you get some medical condition and suddenly the sensors will start to send information out, right? And probably the sensors are sending information all the time, but then the syncs will be the one to sort of just do some simple processing to say forward or not forward. So let's say it's event driven, right? So, the assumption is that from the nano syncs to the gateway is one hop. N is the number of nano syncs. This is the ideal interval, the minimum interval to fully utilize the channel, right? And of course, we can assume that the gateway is able to do that, right? And then the gateway will always be receiving mode and waiting for, you know, information to come, right? So let me just show you in terms of a simple figure. Now, basically, the scheme involves two things. One is how do we actually shift these pulses, right, such that they will fit nicely into this and they will not overlap and collide and cause, you know, problems, right? I said earlier that, you know, it's not going to collide, right? But, you know, life is never so easy, right? You still get collisions, right? So basically, if I have the sync number one with that stream of pulses, sync number two with that stream of pulses, then I have to shift them. For example, sync number one got the channel first, it starts to transmit its pulse to the gateway. Then for sync number two, I have to shift the transmission such that it's ideally I sub S away, right? And then subsequently the next pulse will be here and so forth, right? I cannot blast this whole lot here because I'll overwhelm the channel. We do not want that to happen, right? And this is the ultimate this is the ultimate result that we want, right? Okay. So now how are we going to do that? That's what this whole solution is about. How are we going to do that? So in order to do that, now first and foremost, we are dealing with very simple devices. So we cannot afford complex algorithms. The algorithms must be really simple. And I like it simple because I can't handle complexity. Right, I'm a simple person. Anything more than two dimension, I'm in trouble. So, right. So anyway, so every sync will have these few parameters. Number one, transmission count. Transmission count is basically the number of transmissions. And before I say something, now this is all one hop away. So all the syncs can hear each other when they transmit something. So transmission count, how many packets has already been transmitted in the network, so everyone can hear. S, right? S is the packets that were heard by a sync before they even start to transmit. So it's the previous one, okay? ND, number of neighbors. So obviously, if I can hear others communicating, I know how many neighbors are there. T sub TX1, okay? When did I transmit my first pulse? Because that's the start of my transmission. TRX1. When did I hear the first pulse from somebody else? Okay? So for sync number one, let me assume sync number one transmitted first. Right? Now, there's one thing which is a bit different here is that typically if you're transmitting, you just start off by transmitting. Okay, now remember I said something about in TSOOK, time spread, on off keying, your one means you transmit something. Your zero means you don't transmit anything, right? So you cannot start a packet with zero. Alright? Otherwise you don't know that your packet has started. Okay? So you always start with a one. So for normal transmission, other schemes they always start with one. See, for us we also start with one, right? But then we also follow it with a zero. It's a sort of a way to tell the network that, hey, this is our start of, or the gateway, this is the start of our packet. So the first one is one. Then after it sends the first packet, it waits a long period of time. So how long is this period of time? Basically, it's the total number of sinks in the network, which the gateway knows and tells everybody, times the number of the length of the ideal shortest pulse. So basically, this is our greatest overhead. When we start a new transmission cycle, we always have to wait a long time so that every sink in the network that wants to transmit something gets a chance to transmit. Right, so this is our biggest overhead. Okay? So when that happens, so let's say sink number one, it says, oh, I know what time I transmitted, right? And then I didn't hear anyone else transmit. I heard myself, of course. I do not have any neighbors because I didn't hear anyone else, right? When did I receive another pulse? I didn't receive any other pulse. Okay, so sync one's pulse all the way to there. Duration later, okay, that's what I get. Now sync number two. Okay, sync number two, when sync one transmitted, sync number two said, I heard one transmission before me, therefore there must be one neighbor. Right, there must be one other neighbor. Okay. I haven't transmitted yet, but I've already received a packet. Right? So I have a few counters that I use. Now, how does sync number two then decide its transmission? So basically what we're saying is that sync number one managed to capture the channel, and it is going to start transmitting the moment this initial listening period is over. So this is where it is. Now, how does then sync number two decide to start transmitting here? Because sync number two cannot also try and transmit this slot. So how does it do it? So first of all, what sync number two does is that I will start, first of all, at the end of the long listening period, plus how many previous packets have I heard, basically means how many other syncs there are in the network, multiplied by the ideal interval. And then I take away this little factor, which is basically says that I transmitted my own packet, but I already heard somebody else, right? So this is actually more of just a little shifting factor. Okay? This is actually not very important. So when I actually do this, right? So this is a two sync scenario, right? I basically already say that sync one, you try, this is where you start. Sync two, this is where you start. One I sub s later, and so forth. And then from now on, each of them will just, you know, do that. Okay. So how are we going to do it? So here you go. So sync one, I'm going to start at this time, my first one, and then instead of doing it every I sub s, because there are two syncs in the network, it has to be, so this is sync one, sync one, sync one, sync one. This is sync two, sync two, sync two, and so forth. Right? And if you look at it, nd, number of neighbors, one plus one is two, times the ideal interval plus, of course, the number of the pulse length. So essentially, all the syncs now have computed this gap for them to transmit their pulses. And you notice here, it becomes nicely interleaved naturally. Right? Okay, so that's it. Nice. Okay. Right. Now, performance evaluation. Wow, this is a tough one for us. Why? Because there wasn't anyone else doing similar stuff. Right, and I think if we submit a paper that says no comparison with anyone else, I wouldn't be standing up here talking to you. Right? Okay, so basically, we have to compare with others. Okay? And how do we compare? In terms of bandwidth efficiency, right? This is the bandwidth provided to us by the gateway. This is how many bits we have transmitted. Pulse drop ratio. Now, this is a bit tricky. Pulse drop ratio basically is the number of pulses that the gateway received that exceeded its backhaul bandwidth and dumps. So it's all measured at the gateway. Fairness. Okay? Fairness, because if you notice, naturally our scheme sort of interleaves, well, it should be one of the best. But we do not want to allocate all the bandwidth to one sink and not the others. So we want it to be spread out. Okay? So for example, if you're monitoring your lungs, you do not only want monitoring sensor information to come from one part of your lung and not the rest of your lung, right? Packet delivery ratio, being networking people, this is like, you know, you have to do it, okay? And of course the energy consumption. Right. Now, so like I said, this is where our tough problem is. Who do we compare with? We compare with, okay, so we have to think, who do we compare with? Right, we compare with a very conservative scheme. The one that sends pulses, you know, that once every long interval, okay, long interval. That the long interval is actually useful because the long interval is basically the number of short intervals multiplied by the total number of sinks in the network. So what we're saying is that every time we send one pulse, we wait for the rest of the network to transmit. Then we send another pulse, and then we do that. Right? Not a good idea, but conservative. Random pulse, okay? Same as long interval, but give it some random number. Short pulse, okay, this, like it or not, I'm still CSMA already, you know? So basically what it does is that it listens. If the channel is busy, back off. If the channel is not busy, transmit. Right, and then this is as a random backup. Okay, so I see the chair standing there. He's telling me I better finish up, right? Otherwise, I'm gonna have a whole room full of angry people not having lunch. Right, okay, so quickly, original throughput, okay, the throughput. So basically, the throughput, okay, the way we have done it, obviously, well, okay, now you see 200. 200 is actually the bandwidth of NB-IoT. So for those of you who are not familiar, that is the latest cellular communities IoT technology, right? So we managed to get a few spikes, and that's during the initial period, and then our throughput sort of basically fits that nicely. Right, so efficiency, right? Efficiency. We want to be very efficient. So obviously we're at the very top, okay? But it's so messed up, we have to spread it out and show it to you. Pulse drop ratio. Now, obviously we don't drop that many pulses because we match the band, the backhaul. Right, so we don't drop, but still, nothing is perfect. We still drop something. It's a few, one or two around. Okay, we cannot, you know, we are still far from perfect. Okay? Now, this one is a bit interesting because we want to measure which pulse we actually drop. So for us, actually, we always drop the first one because there's a tendency that the first one has a collision. Fairness, I don't think I need to say much because we are interleaving, so we get everything that's fair. Right, packet delivery ratio, well, we hit 100% or actually close to 100%. Energy consumption, very low. Okay, now, the energy consumption is measured such that if you transmit pulses, it gets dropped by the gateway, you lose it. So we compute the total energy consumed, right? And then we see how much per unit, so we divide it. Right, so I think I'm not gonna go through all this. This is just a lot of performance measures that we derive as average to help you, you know, do some sort of, measuring, right? This is the size of the packet. We're still looking at packets from 32 bits all the way to 256 bits. So obviously there's an overhead. The longer the packet, the better you get in terms of efficiency, right? Energy consumption, that, and the unit energy consumption, right? Okay, so in conclusion, right? As of today, or as of last night, I looked around, I think we are still the first to actually claim this, the IoT, Internet of Nano Things, we are able to achieve high bandwidth efficiency as well as energy efficiency because we don't drop many bits. The more bits you drop, the more energy you lose. Right, so in future work, we assume that the channel is more or less fine, fixed, there's no change, but actually we need to look into that, okay? And then, of course, need all the other bandwidth. The bandwidth will change all the time. The B becomes variable. And of course, if you don't have enough bandwidth, you need multiple gateways. And that's what we are doing. All right, so that's it. Okay, now if you need more information, feel free to send email to any one of us there. Thank you very much. Oh yeah, by the way, I'm not running away. I'm going for lunch, so you can catch me during lunch as well.
Thank you. We do have time for a few short questions.
I want to add two questions.
Yep.
The first one is why the bit drop, if you schedule like this, so it will not collision, so why they bit drop?
Okay, so answering the first question, you realize, okay, that during the initial period, that long setup period, right, we actually use a pretty dumb period in the sense that you just go ahead and transmit. So there's still a possibility that two sinks somehow will collide during the initial period. And that's why some of the bits actually get dropped. Although it is not very possible.
Yeah. I want another question. In your model, you chapter 2 just to sync. But how about 3? I don't imagine.
Right. Okay, good. So that's a good point. Well, I use a two sync model because I hope that it was a bit clearer. So if I have multiple syncs, then the number of neighbors will actually increase, right? And then of course, if I have sync number 3, right, then after sync number 1 transmitted, then sync 2 will have received 1 count. And then when sync 2 transmitted, then this transmission count will go up to 2, and then the third sync will come up, and all these numbers, this one will keep increasing, you know, as each sync goes up. Right, so actually in our paper, we actually have the general model in terms of number of syncs, you know, to handle.
Yes, I'd like to ask about the matching the sampling to the bandwidth. Are you skipping some samples?
Okay, sorry, you mean sampling from the sensor bar?
Yes.
Alright, okay, so this is actually where we, our assumption about how the network model looks like. So what we are actually assuming is that this is where the sampling is done, right? And then the samples will be sent to the Nano 6. Right. So in terms of the samplings, whether we are losing or not, we sort of assume that because this is part of the same application, right, the decision on whether to drop samples and all that should be done here. Whereas this one is something that is a separate part of the network. Right. So there may be samples being dropped, you're correct, that dropped by the nano sinks. Okay, so but that one we assume that is not really something that we should be worried about. We let the nano sinks decide what kind of information they want to forward to us, given
so,
the
yeah. So that's another part of the
correct. Yes.
Yeah. The system has to be tackled by separately.
A lot of people are tackling this part, not us. Right. Actually, there are lots of great algorithms doing this part.
It's really important.
Exactly. You're right. Exactly. So that's actually why, since there is such a great community out there, we found that our contribution will be minimal compared to what we have done. So rather we are looking, and because of our background, we are rather looking at the networking aspect of this.
Okay, really quick question, despite the angry, hungry faces.
It's not my fault, is it?
Thank you. I will not take my time. Sir, did you consider some priority-based things, sending some priority-based pulses? How about that condition?
All right, okay, so you're talking about prioritization, right?
Yeah.
Yes, that will be something that we have to consider later. Right, because this is considered the first step in terms of trying to maximize the bandwidth, right? And yes, I do agree with you that, you know, if we start to consider prioritization, you know, that sort of adds to the sophistication of the model. I sort of avoid the word complexity. Yeah, but I think that's a good suggestion that we need to take into consideration. Thank you.
Okay, I think it would be a good time to end this morning's session since we're standing between you and lunch. So can we thank again the presenters for this session?